Orion presents The Poison Throne, an epic novel of Tumanbay by Walker Dryden, read by Peter Polycarpou. In the course of this audience, the Sultan asked me this question. Have you ever seen a stone that fell from the sky? I replied, I have never seen one, nor heard tell of one. Well, he said, a stone did fall from the sky outside this town of ours. And then called some men and told them to bring in the stone. They brought in a great black stone, very hard and with a glitter in it. I reckoned its weight to amount to 100 weight. The Sultan ordered the stonebreakers to be summoned, and 4 of them came, and on his command to strike it, they beat upon it as one man 4 times with iron hammers, but made no impression on it. I was astonished at this phenomenon, and he ordered it to be taken back to its place. Ibn Battuta, Traveller, 1304 to 1369. The soul becomes dyed with the colour of its thoughts. Marcus Aurelius, Roman Emperor and Stoic Philosopher, 121 to 180. Prologue. An ordinary man, perhaps a little less than average height, wearing an undistinguished brown robe, sandals that were anything but new, walking with a pronounced limp, a slight smile on his face, as if he were recalling a pleasant memory. In his wake, soldiers, armoured and armed. For a moment, it was hard to tell if they were escorting the small man or arresting him. Only when he stopped for a moment at a crossroads and the soldiers came to attention, did it become clear that he was in charge. He looked one way and then the other, pulled a sheet of vellum from his sleeve, consulted it, and set off towards the affluent residences of the Bull Pass quarter. His escort followed. There were 6 of them, but their presence hardly seemed necessary. As the small party progressed, the streets before them emptied of pedestrians, stallholders, of anyone at all, until the group had passed. So intent were they upon their destination that they did not notice the figure following them. Possibly a beggar or some shopkeeper condemned for selling short measure by Maya's police. He took care to stay a street or so behind and to keep his face hidden in the shade of his hood. In due course, the small man came to a halt before the door of a prosperous house and lifted the ornate knocker that proclaimed the owner to be a member of the Guild of Olive Importers. The door opened. A servant peered out, and the small man said pleasantly, "Peace be upon you. And upon you, Effendi. I am sorry to disturb you so late in the afternoon. Is the master at home?" "He is resting. The small man held his hand up. "Let him be. It is the child of the house I wish to speak to." The servant said nothing, but her eyes widened. "Please, don't be alarmed. It is a small matter." He stepped forward. Without thinking, the servant opened the door and he entered the house, followed by 2 of his escort. The others remained in the street. The master of the house, far from resting, was standing behind the door where he had heard the conversation. "You wish to speak to my son? He is saying his prayers." The small man clasped his hands across his narrow chest. "Good. I'll wait, if it's convenient. Oh, please, excuse my escort. I have walked from the palace, and in these times, well, I'm afraid it is necessary." He smiled apologetically, then turned to a woman who entered the room, scolding her husband. "What are you thinking, making a holy man stand, not offering him refreshment?" She knelt to touch the small man's feet. "It is an honour to receive you, holiness, into our home. Food, drink, you must be. We have need of nothing," he said, reaching down and touching her head. "Sister, please don't." "Ah." A smile appeared on his face as he spotted a boy peering around the edge of a door at the far end of the chamber. "This must be your son. Come, child, there is nothing to be frightened of." The boy slid round the door reluctantly. His father hurried over and took his shoulder and led him into the room. Now the small man sat down on a settle and patted the cushion beside him. "Come, sit with me here. We need to talk." "Malik, sit with the Holy Father," the mother said. The boy looked at the soldiers standing against the wall of the room. The small man added, "Oh, don't mind them, Malik. They won't let me leave the palace without them trailing behind. Can you imagine it?" He chuckled, and a tiny smile appeared for a moment on the boy's face. "Good. Now, how do you like school?" "It's all right," the boy mumbled shyly. "Ah, you are one of the lucky ones. I didn't have such a good education as you. Tell me about your teacher." A silence in which the only sound was the ticking of a clock. Such novelties, imported from over the Middle Sea, were popular with the merchant class. The father was looking as if he wished he'd never seen the thing or could throw it out now. "What do you call him?"
"Master Odo."
"Master Odo. Good. Good. And Master Odo teaches you about the scriptures? And tells you how a young man should live his life according to God's law?"
"Yes."
The small man's head tilted, his eyes narrowing as he appraised the child. Eventually he said, "I have heard he tells other things too." The boy's cheeks began to redden. He looked to his father, who nodded encouragingly. "Tell the Holy Father everything, Malik," he said. "You have nothing to hide." His mother approached with a servant carrying a tray of refreshments. "Now, Holiness, please don't insult us by declining our hospitality. It is hot and..." "No," the small man snapped. "But you must be..." "I said no." Without taking his eyes off the boy, he waved her away. "Stand beside your husband," he commanded. "Tell the servant to go." She gave her husband a concerned look and then nodded to the servant, who left the room.
"You look worried, Malik," the small man said, warmth returning to his voice. "Don't be. Do you know what makes us strong? When I say strong, I mean without fear of what might happen to us." The boy shook his head. "No. It is the truth that makes us strong, God's gift to us. That is why I, Barakat, have a reputation for never uttering a lie. Never. That is my strength. That can be your strength, too. Do you understand me?" He paused, waiting for a response. Eventually, the boy nodded.
"We have brought our son up to always tell the truth, Holiness," the father said. "Haven't we, Malik? Tell him. Tell him." "You see, it has come to my attention," Barakat continued, now addressing the parents, "that there is a heretic in your son's school." He was almost apologetic. "I swear we know nothing of this," the mother burst out. Of course, how could you? You are not trained. You expect that when you send your children to school, their teachers will show them the true path. We are living in dangerous times. Not everyone is who they seem to be. Are you saying that our son's teacher, he has visited?" Barakat said, nodding sadly.
"What?"
"This house." Malik was falling behind in his recitations. We paid for extra lessons.
"Of course. I understand."
Barakat took the child's hand in his. "If only all parents were so diligent, my work in Tumanbay would be unnecessary." "If our child has done anything wrong," the mother cried, "tell us and we shall beat him." Barakat turned back to the boy, still holding his hand. "Soldiers came to your school today, looking for your teacher. Where was he?"
The child now had his chin pressed against his chest and his eyes squeezed shut, as if trying to shut out all around him.
"Did someone tell him soldiers were coming?"
Gently, he squeezed the boy's hand, not causing pain, rather reassuring him.
"You can tell me, Malik. I know already. I know everything. I just need you to tell me so I know you are a good boy. You know where Master Odo went, don't you?"
"No, that's not... How could he?" his mother cried. Barakat leaned close to the child and whispered, "You have a chance to save yourself, Malik. We know everything already."
"He's just a child,"
his mother wept. "Every child, every teacher in every school, every soul is important to us, especially one so young as yours." Malik was sobbing now, sucking in heaving breaths, his shoulders convulsing. "You are feeling distressed. It is natural to feel distressed. You are trying to hide from God, but nobody can hide from God. I am his eyes. God sees all, and all will answer to him. You know how to save yourself. So I will ask again. Where is the master?" The boy seemed calm. Without a word, he lifted his head, opened his eyes, and looked into Barakat's. Then he raised his arm and pointed at the door by which he had entered. Barakat nodded, and the soldiers hurried through into the rooms beyond.
"No," his mother said, "he's confused. You are confusing him."
She clasped her husband's arm as if she might collapse. Barakat let go of the boy's hand and rose to his feet. From the adjacent room came the noise of searching, the crash of furniture overturned, cupboards ripped open. After a moment, the soldiers returned.
"Nothing, Holiness."
The parents breathed again. Barakat waved at the house door and one of his men opened it. Those he had left outside entered now with a figure in the robes of a teacher struggling in their grip. He was howling for mercy, an inarticulate wail of sheer terror.
"Climbing out a back window, Holiness, as you said."
The mother rushed to clasp her son. For a moment, Barakat observed them with vague interest as she hugged him and ran her hands through his hair.
"Take the parents too," he said eventually.
It took three soldiers to prise the mother's grip from her child. The father stood stunned, looking at the clock, as if it alone was the author of all their misfortunes.
"And the child?"
asked one of the soldiers.
"Leave him. He has saved himself."
He sat for a moment beside Malik, like a kindly uncle.
"You see, God takes care. God takes care of all. The truth sets you free."
He limped out, leading his men and their prisoners into the afternoon sun. From his position across the street behind the gnarled trunk of an ancient fig tree, the shrouded figure of Gregor watched the sad procession. Maya had come to Tumanbay, and Barakat the Inquisitor was her instrument. That slight figure in the dusty robe and the old sandals was the personification of her power, and Gregor, for the first time since childhood, knew fear. "The truth will make you free," he muttered, "or Barakat's truth will destroy me."
Part 1.
There's a city far away. My parents often spoke of it as if it had always been there and always would be. I had seen it in paintings. I had read of it in stories. The richest, most powerful place on earth. The centre of everything. It drew people from every corner of the empire and beyond, hungry for wealth and power, or in some cases, more wealth and more power. They were dazzled by its brightness. And then a shadow fell. A shadow called Maya, whose forces smashed the empire from within. Those who followed her did so with a fanatical loyalty and imposed a harshness, a strictness which crushed all opposition, all opinion, all joy and hope. Some said she was the widow of a minor provincial governor who had received a revelation. Others swore she was the very hand and sword of the teacher come to punish the sinful. Yet others maintained that she was an illusion, or that her spirit occupied 100,000, 100,000. But one thing was certain. Maya held the city in her grip and was, like a hunting spider, slowly and with utter certainty, sucking the life from Tumanbay. Chapter 1.
the bodies.
Gabriel flicked the whip and cracked it between the ears of his ancient horse. The beast shook its head and otherwise ignored him, as if it knew he'd never actually lay on with the lash, since it would certainly keel over and die, and then where would he be? A courier without a horse to pull his cart, a bit of a joke. Rather like the city of Tumanbay, he thought, but very quietly. Nowadays, even what went on inside a man's head could get him into trouble. The horse farted thunderously.
"Truly," Gabriel called to the gate guard, "this animal has the arse of the devil himself."
The guard didn't even crack a glimmer of a smile. He simply held out his hand and said, "Papers." Gabriel was in a quandary. Should he slip the usual bribe between the travel pass and his permissions to trade, or should he not? He didn't know this guard, and the fellow obviously had no sense of humour as far as farting horses went, something that rarely failed to raise at least a smile in the old days. But these were the new, unsmiling days.
"Here, Excellency."
No harm in a bit of flattery.
"I have a special consignment for the university."
The guard took the papers and began to peer at them with the exaggerated care of a man who can barely read. There would be more rigorous inspections within the city now that each area had been sectioned off with checkpoints manned by Maya's police.
"The university," the guard said. "That's great, my friend. For a doctor there, an important man high in the confidence of the Inquisitor himself."
Gabriel had no idea this was true, but it seemed likely. He decided to take a chance and went on.
"I see you do important work here at the gate, Excellency. I wonder if I might show my appreciation with..." "We work only for the glory of God," the guard said, expertly receiving the small silver coin from Gabriel's hand as he returned the documents.
"You may pass." The Grand Trunk Road was quieter than he'd ever known. Years before, Gabriel had cause to pass it at midnight, and it had been busier then than it was now. Oh, there was activity. Camel trains, carts and mules, some piled with goods, but none piled high, none with any urgency about them. There were people on foot, going this way and that, again with the appearance of activity. But it all reminded Gabriel of his cousin Attar's beehives. When a queen had died or was sickening, and the hive was, to all intents and purposes, busy with worker bees and drones buzzing around as usual, but on closer inspection, it was not as usual at all. None of them had any urgent purpose. They were merely doing what they always did because there was nothing else to do. That was what Gabriel was seeing as he made his way through district after district, each time showing his pass to one of the black-robed functionaries who examined it with real care, and to whom he certainly did not offer so much as a hint of a bribe. On many street corners, gallows had been built, most with bodies hanging, old and new, each sad corpse labelled with the crime for which they had suffered. Gabriel read some of them as the dead swung on their ropes and the wind stirred their robes and made the scrawled placards flutter. "He sold short measure. He cheated his customers. She offended against the eye of holiness. He sinned by his breath." Did that mean he drank wine, or worse? Gabriel decided that this would be a dry trip, though he doubted if his old haunts even existed anymore in this cleansed new world. "His mouth offended the ear." A placard attached to the body of a child. Gabriel shivered. How could a child's mouth ever warrant more than a sharp word or slap around the back of the head? Parties of soldiers, often no more than fanatical volunteers, a black headscarf their only uniform, passed up and down the streets, stopping and questioning people in what seemed to be a random fashion. He was glad indeed that his papers were of the most respectable kind, though whether that word had any meaning in Tumanbay was a question for later, when he was back home, far away from this pestilential city. He had made up his mind this would be his last consignment, unless, of course, the doctor offered him. How much? Yes, he wondered. How much gold did a man need when he was hanging in the wind?
You! Halt!
From the shadows, a black guard appeared, one of Maya's elite soldiers, responsible for protecting the palace. His clothing was tattered and stained. Only the black scarf tied around his head was new. That and the sword he held.
Excellency?
Gabriel pulled up. The horse snorted, and he climbed down. Best to be humble and respectful, even if you did have good papers.
Where are you going? What is your business?
Gabriel went through it all for the 10th, or was it the 12th time since passing the gate? At this rate, he'd never be done. The guard waved the papers.
This doesn't say what you're carrying. It only mentions that you have permission to transport two boxes. Where are the boxes?
Gabriel walked round to the cart where, clearly visible, the boxes lay under a cover on the flat wooden bed, tied down with cords.
Let me see. The doctor is none of my business. You are. Let me see, and be quick about it.
Of course, Effendi.
He hopped up onto the cart, freed the cover and swept it back. He wrapped the lids. Dampness had oozed through the planking in places.
Here, as you see, two boxes, urgent, for the university.
And what is in your boxes, courier?
Excellency?
Answer my question.
Dead bodies, Excellency, fresh, packed in ice, but as you can see, it has melted now. Time is passing.
Perhaps the guard was thinking, why two more bodies in a city where there are already so many to be had? Whatever was in his mind, something gave him pause. He looked again at the papers, at the tiny sigil right at the end, next to the official wax seal, modest and unshowy, the sigil of the Inquisitor. After a long moment, he said,
very well, be on your way. Waste no time, go.
Keeping his mouth shut, Gabriel recovered the boxes, hurried back to his seat, flicked the reins, prayed the horse didn't fart again. That was probably a hanging offence now. He offended the nose of holiness and drove off.
Chapter 2. Gregor.
The palace was silent. Like the streets, there was activity. Servants went from room to room. Clerks and chamberlains carried out the few functions that still remained to them. But the life of the place, the ceaseless hum of activity that coursed like blood through the body of the building, day and night, the thousand and one tasks that had to be carried out to ensure the great empire of Tumanbay continued to function, that hum was no more. Life, however, went on in the new way. And in the Hall of 1,000 Pillars, which had been stripped of their fine tiles and gold relief, seated at the plain table, which had replaced the grandeur of Sultan al-Guri's throne, Effendi Red, regent of the city in the name of his mistress, was holding his morning council meeting. The silk curtains had gone, the floor tiles with the crescent moon had been taken up and shipped out, the splendid guards had been replaced by the black guard. A black-robed cleric sat before a ledger, noting down the words that were spoken in the code of his order, and could not therefore be denied at a later time, should they prove treasonous, or worse, heretical. The morning was hot. Sunlight flooded in through the high windows, from which the stained glass was being removed by workmen atop wooden scaffolding that creaked and groaned. But the chamber was, Gregor felt, chilly, like a morgue, and of late, he had become something of a connoisseur of morgues. He stood to one side of the table at which Red sat, facing the Inquisitor, Barakat. A small group of palace officials waited to be called upon if necessary. They had one and all managed to turn their coats in the interest of survival, as had Gregor. They still called him commander, but it meant nothing at all. There was no palace guard to command, and he was no more than a fixer for the new regime, his position dependent on his continued obedience. It was not, he reflected, a spectacle that said a lot for the dignity of man. But then, where had a principled Stan got his brother, Qulan? Barakat was talking.
The households in the old abattoir district, he said, I believe it was called Meat Alley or some such name.
And what is the problem, Inquisitor? Red asked.
Heresy. We believe heretics from the city are finding sanctuary there. The people have never been of an obedient class. They were despised by the previous regime, regarded as thieves and villains.
Red caught Gregor's eye.
Is that so, Commander?
The Inquisitor is, as always, correct, Excellency. In the old days, the authorities rarely ventured into those slums, and never without an escort. It is said the original settlers there were travellers who, Barakat cut across his words, spare us the history lesson. Do you not yet understand that history is dead? We create the future. That is our task. His voice dripped with contempt.
And regarding this problem? Red asked.
If there are indeed heretics hiding there, what do you recommend?
House searches have been less than effective. The commander is correct on that point.
What do you recommend?
Burn it down. The words were flat and unemotional, and all the more shocking for it.
That would be unfortunate, Red said.
Heresy is a plague, Excellency. It breeds rebellion. These people, these rebels, burn down our temples, they poison wells, assassinate officials. Their ideas will fester and grow in that rat run of shanties. It is necessary to solve the problem before it gets worse.
If we do it, some will die who are not heretics.
Then they will be walking in the paradise gardens whilst the others burn eternally.
Red looked again at the map, then waved it away.
I will think and pray on it.
Even so, Barakat let the words hang. Red raised an eyebrow. He was, Gregor thought, the only man in the city who did not appear to fear or at least defer to the Inquisitor. The only free man.
There will need to be an order issued by the city magistrates.
Red was no fool, and knew well that the wise conqueror uses the systems that are already in place to establish order and control.
Gregor, that you can arrange, if required.
I can, Excellency.
The question was hardly necessary. He did what he was told.
And our Sultan, of course, will have to agree.
Discreet smirks appeared on the faces of the functionaries. Sultan Madu the Magnificent, the adopted son of the old Sultan al-Guri, was a figurehead, there to convince the people of Tumanbay that all was normal as their city was ripped apart around them.
Even so, Red said, the burning down of an entire area of the city. I have served Maya in Maduk, Asaira, Saldan, and other lands, none of which are anything like Tumanbay. Maduk is a small desert town.
Gregor was under no illusion about what he was watching. A battle for supremacy between two powerful men, neither of whom, he suspected, had any love for the other. Barakat inclined his head and replied,
a fortress, nonetheless, which, if it had not been brought under control, and brought under control by my work, would have risen up again like a sickness in the body. My dear Regent, conquest is only the beginning. Any army, if it is large enough, can take a town, a city, an empire, but keeping it, holding it.
He held out his hand, his fingers cupped as if he were in fact holding a tiny, invisible empire.
This is not about how many soldiers or slaves you have, but about the souls that we have conquered.
He closed his hand, making his point clear. Arms mean nothing. The spirit means everything.
And that, Effendi Red, is why you need me.
Red stood, pushing back his chair and bowed to the room. He said quietly,
Inquisitor, there will be no burning down of sections of this city, not whilst I am regent of Tumanbay.
Thank you for your time. The council is over. The cleric hastily noted the words down, the pen nib scratching on the vellum. He sprinkled white sand to dry the ink, blew it from the page, and closed the book.
Barakat bowed and said simply,
as you wish, my lord.
They waited until Red had left the room. Then Barakat said,
Gregor, with me."
Gregor had no option but to follow. The Inquisitor hurried along the corridor, his lameness not impeding his pace at all. Gregor had to lengthen his stride to keep up. Where were they going? What task did Barakat have for him?
"Ah, Holiness!"
Kadali, the late Grand Vizier, now toady-in-chief to Barakat.
"Is this a convenient time, Holiness?"
He stood as if he were a thin man, rather than the imposing figure he was, trying to take up less space than he did.
"Convenient for what?"
"I simply wish to inform you that I have just dispatched another consignment of treasures from the palace to Maya, our mistress and our guiding light."
There was nothing Kadali did not know about the palace. No hidden storeroom, overlooked corridor, forgotten cellar, no tapestry hanging in an obscure corner, no money box in a clerk's office that he could not put his finger on, and as such, he had proved invaluable to the new masters of the city, who were turning the treasures of centuries into gold for new crusades. Even so, he exuded a perpetual scent of anxiety. Barakat nodded.
"I hope you are satisfied with my work, Holiness?"
Gadali bowed, as if he were delivering the favoured child of the mother of all bows. Even Gregor was impressed. Barakat was not.
"Satisfied? I am merely a servant in God's household. We all answer to him and him alone."
"Well, yes," Gadali mumbled. "Yes, I just wanted to let you know, to keep you..."
"Peace be with you."
"And with you," Barakat strode off.
"So glad you're here,"
Kadali called after him.
"Truly, Kadali, you are the great Sultan of all arse-lickers," Gregor said. "I need to speak with you, Gregor."
The tone was urgent. Kadali's eyes narrowed with fear.
"What?"
"Not now, not here, later."
And he was gone. Gregor hurried after his master.
"So what do you think, Gregor?"
"About Kadali, Holiness."
Barakat came to a sudden halt and turned to Gregor, looking up into his face.
"Kadali doesn't matter, as you well know. The regent. What do you think he should do in this case?"
"I would take the advice of Maya's Inquisitor."
Sometimes, Gregor felt, he even shocked himself. But since he himself was the cause he most cared about, surely anything was permissible to ensure survival. Without it, nothing was possible. If only Qulan had thought like that. Then perhaps they both might. Barakat was striding on with his lopsided gait. Gregor caught up and said,
"Otherwise, I would seek to place spies amongst them."
"And how would you know if you could trust them?"
"I would tell them that I had set spies to watch the spies. And besides, they would be working for a cause they believed in."
"The true faith."
Gregor could have told him the cause itself didn't matter as long as the spies believed in it.
Any dream, any distant hope would do. "Exactly, Holiness. Find the true believers, and they will risk all to serve Maya."
They entered Barakat's administrative section, housed in the old Hall of Mirrors. The walls were empty now, the beautiful crystal and glass sold, the ornate and ancient frames fuel for the kitchens. Clerks sat at rows of desks, filling in ledgers from sheets delivered by clerics who had the dust of the streets upon their black hems. They were out all hours gathering information. A head clerk hurried across with an open ledger which he presented to the Inquisitor.
"These are the heads of households in the merchant's district, Holiness, as you commanded."
"I command nothing, my friend. It is God who asks this task of us. We merely obey. Every man, woman, child, dog, every cart, every beggar in Tumanbay must be accounted for."
"Indeed, Holiness, we are basing our new records on the old civil returns, but checking them against current conditions."
"And the abattoir district?"
"There are areas to which we still have not gained access," the clerk said.
"You see, Gregor, there is a problem. What is unaccounted is unknown. I believe you can help me with this matter."
He nodded to the clerk, and returned to his bench.
"I shall investigate personally, Holiness," Gregor said.
"Of course you will. Oh, and one more thing. The Sultan Madu."
It sounded like an afterthought, but Gregor knew the Inquisitor never forgot anything.
"Yes, he was ill."
"Someone is supplying him with opiates. The regent doesn't care. He prefers the Sultan to live this half-life. But I am curious to know who is responsible. Find out."
Chapter 3. Doran. The bodies had been unloaded and carried into the university. As usual, Doran had been impatient, but that suited Gabriel. He was in no hurry to stay in this damn city. As he climbed back onto the cart, he said,
"Thank you, Effendi Doctor. I'm afraid this will have to be the last deliveries.
Supplies have dried up."
"No, it's just that Hassan will give you the passes and permissions as you leave. It's just that the black card, they are none of your concern. You will not be stopped. The fee will be increased. Here, in advance."
More gold in his hand. And now he, Gabriel, knew just how much it would take to risk another trip. He clicked his tongue, and the old horse gathered itself, and they rolled out of the yard and back into the city. Doran watched them go, then turned and hurried back into the building. He had a class waiting for him and did not like to be late. Maya, or her regent Red, had seen it as their religious duty to show charity to the poor in matters of health, and the hospital still functioned, as did the medical faculty at the university, and Doran, formerly a junior teacher, had been promoted to head the department after his old chief had been informed on and arrested for heresy. Doran had found himself favoured by the new regime and was not prepared to risk his position by any lack of zeal. He took a scalpel from the leather-lined case that lay on the slab beside the first body and was about to make an incision. He addressed his audience of students, sitting on raised benches, so they could more easily observe the procedures. "As you see, I am going to cut from just above the breastbone. The vital fluids have drained to the anterior organs of the body, and..." He paused. A few of the students emitted a shocked grunt or gave a sharp intake of breath as a woman entered. Quite clearly and obviously a woman of middle age, tall, cloaked, wearing a turban with a rippling silk fringe, dark-eyed, of firm and confident step. Whispering broke out amongst the watchers. This must be the one they had heard of, Alkin, a doctor in her own right, as if such things could ever be, who seemed to have a pass to wherever she wished to go in the university. Without waiting for an invitation, she joined Doran beside the body. His displeasure was clear. He waved to the students.
"You may take some time. Write up your notes from yesterday. We will continue this procedure in a moment."
Hastily, they left.
"What are you doing here, Doctor?" Doran said.
"I am observing, Doctor. I have a question."
"I have a dissection to carry out."
"And I still have a question."
With an expression that said quite clearly, "This damned woman cannot take a hint," Doran snapped, "Well?"
"This is the third fresh delivery in as many weeks."
"So?
Aren't there enough dead people in Tumanbay for you to..."
"You ask too many questions, Doctor."
"Isn't that our job as doctors?"
"Then you've answered your own question," Doran said.
"I have."
Doran stepped away from the table and clasped his hands behind his back, as was his habit when addressing an audience.
Alkin smiled very slightly at the man's vanity.
"Consider it by God's grace. Everyone knows that Tumanbay is a city of sin. Sin manifests itself in disease. Therefore, those living in the city, at least a large proportion of the sinners, must be suffering from disease. Indeed, so endemic is sin that one might say that they are suffering from a disease of the soul."
"Surely you don't..."
Alkin got no further. Doran was in no mood to be halted.
"You have, for some reason, Dr. Alkin, been granted permission by the regent to go where you wish in this university. I do not approve, but I must accept that judgment. Very well, so be it. However,
I expect you to accept equally my position here. I do not like being interrupted in front of my students. I will not stand for it. Whoever your mentor may be, if you wish to watch, you will watch respectfully and in silence. Is that clear?
Silently, Alkin inclined her head.
Very well. Perhaps you would oblige me by summoning my students so we can continue.
Again, Alkin inclined her head.
I do not wish to make an enemy of you, Doctor, nor do I advise you to make one of me. Today I will oblige you.
She left the room and shortly returned, followed by the students, who exuded a palpable air of disapproval. The dissection was well advanced when the Inquisitor and Gregor entered the cool room. Doran finished the incision he was making within the chest cavity, then stepped back a pace.
Ah, Holiness, may I be of service?
Please, carry on. We will watch, Dr. Alkin.
Barakat nodded to the tall woman.
Holiness, she murmured.
As Doran continued with his work, describing each procedure as he performed it, Barakat drew Gregor back to the edge of the room and talked quietly.
I don't understand the holy sciences myself, but I believe they can point us to many of the answers we seek.
Gregor had not taken the Inquisitor for a patron of learning. Perhaps he had misjudged the man.
Much good can be done for people through medicine, Holiness.
Barakat didn't seem to hear him, but went on, the soul, for instance.
The soul? Peeling back viscera, Doran said, here we enter the secret chambers of the body.
The students craned forward.
Barakat said, if it were possible to find whereabouts in the body the soul resides, then it may be possible to cure it of sin at the very fount of life.
The organs you see before you, Doran instructed, are those written of in the ancient books. Within them reside the humours of the body,
Barakat said. Sin is a disease of the soul. Often it manifests itself in sickness of the body, the crippled, the palsied, and lepers. If we can treat the soul, we can treat the disease. Do you see?
I see, Gregor thought, that I am in the company of a madman, but replied, of course, Inquisitor, it makes perfect sense when you put it that way. We are, Doran said, to observe from nature, then test what we see against the wisdom of the ancient texts and the holy scriptures, and draw our conclusions.
For the first time since he had met the Inquisitor, Gregor was seeing excitement in his usually controlled manner. He said,
so, we are to compare the bodies of known sinners, the citizens of Tumanbay, with those, like these that the doctor is now examining, brought from farming communities, untouched by the wickedness of the city. Then we shall see the difference and, we hope, discover where the soul lies.
He raised his voice.
Is that not so, Doctor? We aim to locate the soul of man.
Doran looked up, appearing at least to Gregor's eyes like a man following a narrow path across quicksand, and answered, yes, that is our hope. Indeed it is. Gregor caught the eye of the woman Alkin, who was observing from the other side of the room. She gave no sign of her opinion, offered nothing to him. Her presence, her ability to go where she wished, was one more mystery. In the old days, he would have had her in his cellars, and she would have answered all his questions. Now, she was a wall without windows. Barakat advanced on the slab.
Of course. He was addressing the room now. We cannot be certain of the purity of the bodies brought in, although I believe this one did come from...
Before Doran could answer, Alkin spoke. A village near the swamps?
It is where we have obtained all our specimens, Doran put it. His expression made his feeling about this woman quite plain.
Barakat ignored him. He said to Gregor,
Dr. Alkin is a traveller from the East, a fine mind. I discovered her in Asyra. She found herself trapped there just before the city was liberated by Maya.
I was indeed likely to die there, but, as the Inquisitor says, was saved by the hand of Maya. Wielding the sword of God, I was able to aid the cause in some small ways.
in many ways, Barakat said, which is why I wish her to aid our most eminent physician in his researches.
Dorin's features were paler than that of the corpse on his slab. This was obviously a complete surprise to him.
Inquisitor, I can assure you that I do not need...
He fell silent as Barakat raised his right hand, the forefinger extended.
The Inquisitor said nothing. He merely smiled. It was not a good smile, and Dorin swallowed nervously.
He turned to the students. I think that concludes things for today. Obediently, they trooped off and were hardly through the door before the buzz of gossip broke out.
Dorin reached for the mortuary cloth to pull it over the body. Alkin stayed his hand.
Wait, Doctor.
She leaned forward, took up his scalpel, and moved aside a flap of muscle.
Here, by the lungs. A lesion.
Yes, I noticed that too. Quite common in farming communities. Comes from grain dust in the air during winnowing.
Possibly, Alkin said, and possibly not.
Barakat leaned forward.
What is it? Can it be? The soul? Has Dr. Dorin found it?
Not the soul, I think, and I can't be sure until I examine the other body.
Dorin had taken up a glass and was examining the lesion through it. No love was lost between the two doctors, but they were both masters of their trade. He said reluctantly, Yes, we must look. Here, let me...
He plucked the blade from Alkin's fingers and swiftly opened up the lung.
More lesions. The two looked at each other.
What is it?
Barakat demanded. Dorin stepped back, leaving it to his colleague to deliver the bad news. Wherever these bodies come from, there is sickness.
I have seen it before,
Dorin nodded.
It is a travelling sickness. I fear that unless measures are taken, it will come to Tumanbay.
Chapter 4. Kudali. The great court, which had housed Al-Ghuri's collection of statues from the ancient world, was empty of sculptures now. Most of the collection had been sent away to be sold. Some, the most blasphemous, had been smashed by the Black Guard, and lumps of stone still lay on the floor amongst the other debris.
Kudali bent and picked up a piece of rough cast. Turning it, he found himself looking at an eye, exquisitely carved, almond-shaped, alluring even in its ruin. Perhaps it had come from the statue commissioned to commemorate the old Sultan's wife, Shaja, murdered by Maya's agency. Kudali let it fall, and it became lost in the rubble. Dust drifted from above, where workmen were disconnecting and lowering the first of the great chandeliers, 10 of them, each bearing 1,000 candles, which had illuminated the gallery after dark. To have been in that room as candle time dawned, to have mingled with the crowds of courtiers, ambassadors, and visitors from all over the world, to have heard the music often specially commissioned for the evening, to have watched the dancers as they moved through the perfumed mists, that, Kudali knew, was to have seen Tumanbay at its finest. And now, this.
Kudali, Kudali.
A voice whining, cajoling, and Madu slipped into the room, looking more like a criminal than the Sultan of Tumanbay. He scuttled through the debris, his eyes glittering with need. Have you got it? He actually pulled at Kudali's sleeve.
Here, Majesty.
A small package wrapped in silvery paper was handed over. Madu took it like a low trader accepting a bribe. So far had he fallen. Kudali had never really liked the boy or approved of his blatant behaviour or his unsuitable relationships, but he had at least been conscious of his position and, in the last days, before his lover Daniel had vanished, he had shown a certain dignity. Now, a shadow sultan, he was a drug-haunted wreck.
Is it Megila?
Yes, the very best. The sultan pulled open a corner of the package and tipped powder onto the back of his hand.
Let me try.
He sniffed, long and deep.
Majesty, Kudali said, not here, I beg you. Please keep it to your chambers.
Madu smiled.
his face at peace.
I don't care. I don't care what they do to me.
He slipped the packet under his robes.
No, but this could compromise me. And then where would you get your Megilla?
And that you do care about.
Yes, yes. I'll be...
A clatter, as a wooden baton fell. An echo. Footsteps grinding on the stone dust that coated the floor. With a sense of doom, Kudali spun and faced Gregor. He breathed out. The man was not deadly anymore, but he could still be dangerous.
Commander, what brings you here at this time? Aren't you supposed to be inspecting something?
I wanted to be sure that His Majesty was feeling better. He missed the Regent's morning meeting.
The unsaid words might have continued, to which you were not invited.
Thank you for your concern, Gregor. If you will excuse me, I have some business to attend.
Madu hurried off.
They both watched him go. Another shout from above, and the first chandelier began to wobble down on a net of ropes, bringing a waterfall of dust with it. The two moved to the side of the room.
A complex business, dismantling an empire, Gregor said.
Kadali didn't dignify the remark with a reply.
What do you want, Gregor?
The ex-spymaster flicked a glance all around to be sure no one was close, then spoke quietly.
You need to stop. The drugs. They're watching you. It won't end well. That's my gift to you.
And like so many of your gifts, it's a poisoned one.
How so?
Please, Gregor, don't play the idiot with me. Yes, the Inquisitor wants you to find out who is supplying Madu with drugs. Oh, are you surprised I know?
Not really. Go on.
At the same time, Effendi Red requires Madu to function as a figurehead, which means he needs the drugs.
Creaks and groans came from the hall, and the chandelier continued its descent. From this angle, closer to the ground, its sheer size became apparent. Hanging, Gadali reflected, it had seemed light and airy, but now it was bulky and unwieldy.
It's a nightmare, he said. They want everything recorded, every last detail. What there is in the palace, who does what, where they do it, how long it takes. Everything has to be written down. And when everything is written down, what then? Do we become...
He couldn't go on. Somehow, the fall of the chandelier had brought about this confession. He was a fool. He was putting himself in Gregor's power, and yet he had wanted to talk to the man, to ask his advice. Was he a total fool, going to his enemy for help?
You need to make yourself invaluable, Gregor said.
How?
Don't tell them everything. Hold information back.
Easy for you. You were used to action, to all this physical stuff, killing, torturing.
Yes, well, you might say I've met my masters in that department.
He gave a dry laugh.
It's no joke, Gregor.
Workmen were wheeling an iron-shod cart into the room, ready to receive the chandelier. The grinding of the wheels was loud, and Kadali spoke urgently under its cover. I have a collection of paintings, rare miniature portraits of the Valantia school. Beautiful, perfect, real. A sob escaped him. His eyes were wet. If anyone were to discover them... I know you know what would happen.
Why did you tell me that?
Gregor was furious.
Why did you involve me? Throw them away, burn them, get rid of them.
Was the man actually frightened? He never knew with Gregor, but of late he had seemed diminished.
I can't, don't you see? They're so beautiful. If they were lost to the world.
Gregor silenced him with an angry gesture.
Don't. Tell me you care about the world or preserving anything other than your own skin, Kadali. The truth, or I walk away now.
Yes, the truth.
Kadali knew nothing else would do. Gregor could inform on him as easily as snapping his fingers.
If I have to run, I'll need to pay my way. The smugglers, the captain of the ship.
Ah, that's better.
One of the workmen was swearing at his mates as they attempted to settle the chandelier securely on the cart, a monotonous, unending stream of obscenity. It seemed to Kadali a good accompaniment to this dismal scene.
I want to sell them.
I'll take a mark down. Only all the traders, the artisans, they fled the city or been executed.
So you want my advice?
You know everyone, Gregor. There's no shabby little corner you haven't seen into in this city.
I'll take that as a compliment. I assume you meant it to be.
Kadali nodded frantically. Of course you know I've always respected your... Help me. Please. I'm begging you.
Burn them.
I can't. Kadali wailed. He needed the money. He'd given everything else to Maya. It had seemed sensible at the time. They're my insurance. Everyone has to prepare for a time when they have to run, even you. Can't you see that, Gregor? The cursing behind them came to a sudden stop. Both men turned to look into the room. The rubble underfoot was causing no problems for the Inquisitor. He almost seemed to float above the mess, across the room, past the workmen to the annex where they stood. Gadali felt sweat springing out on his forehead, rolling down his nose.
Ah, Gregor, here you are.
Gregor bowed.
I have a message from Lord Red. He wants you to go and see your brother.
Was Gregor back in favour, Gadali wondered? Or was this just another of the Inquisitor's games?
It seems the regent may have a use for him, Barakat said, then shrugged. This is a chance for you. Don't waste it.
He turned to go, then paused and said to Gadali, What were you talking about?
The ex-grand vizier opened his mouth to answer, but no sound came out. A drop of sweat fell from the tip of his nose and splashed onto his notes. He saw it fall as if time itself was slowing down. With a supreme effort, he croaked,
Nothing?
But you were talking, the Inquisitor said.
How can it be about nothing? No man talks about nothing. It is not reasonable,
From the room behind them came a shout of,
Let go! Let go easy!
And the sound of a block and pulley squeaking as ropes were detached and raised.
The chandeliers!
Kadali gabbled. We were talking about transporting them safely, how... Once they are all taken down, you see. A sheen of sweat covered his face. Barakat said, Give me your hands. Kadali didn't move, so the Inquisitor reached out and took them himself, his hands thin and bony against the plumpness of Kadali's.
They are shaking, trembling. Why?
Gadali felt his lips trembling, his breath short, and an utter loss of speech. He could not have uttered a word to save his life.
You can tell me, Gadali. And if you wanted to remain between us, it shall. That is my promise. We can send Gregor away if you like. And everyone knows that I never lie. The truth shall make you free. Is that not so, Gregor?
Yes, Inquisitor.
Yes, Gregor. Now, what were you talking about, Kadali?
With an effort that wrenched his soul within, Kadali spoke.
I fear I cannot serve as I should. Much as I try, I keep failing. There is always something more I could be doing, and yet there is no time. Or the workmen go home to their families. I strive
to serve with all my heart, but I fail.
They were rolling the laden cart out of the chamber whilst the scaffolding was moved onto the next chandelier. For a moment, the noise drowned out their words. Kadali caught the phrase,
Prayer and fasting, and keep always busy about her business. None of us achieves perfection. That lies with God alone.
And, having made his point, Barakat patted Kadali on the shoulder and walked away.
You see, Gregor? No one is safe. He was telling us, both of us.
But the sword can fall on any one of us and at any moment. If you keep your nerve.
I could have been convicted because my hands were shaking, man. We are living on borrowed time. The Duns are at the door, and we don't even speak their language. How can we ever be safe?
I need a way out when things get bad.
After a long silence, during which both men listened to the workman, swearing again now that the Inquisitor had gone, proving that they were genuine Tumanbay workmen, Gregor nodded to himself as if making up his mind.
There's a slave merchant in the city. He used to collect rare books, scrolls, such things. I'm not saying he will help you. His name is Ibn Bai. You have all the records. I imagine you can find him. But really, Kadali, I would burn them.
For a moment, Kadali almost felt like embracing his old enemy, but decided that that would be too much for Gregor to swallow. He said,
"Thank you, Gregor. You know you will always have my undying loyalty."
"I doubt it, Kadali. You know what they say about cats and dogs? A dog will remember a day's kindness for 7 years. A cat will forget 7 years' kindness in a day. You were always a cat. And I will deny we ever had this conversation."
He turned and walked away. Kadali watched him, wondering if it would be more profitable to betray the ex-spymaster than accept his help. Chapter 5. Ibn Bai. The hottest hour of the afternoon. Dust hanging motionless in the still air. Even the camels tied up along the dockers' stations were listless, like their masters. For there was little work to be had in the once great port of Tumanbay. No foreign ships entering through the heads, no cargoes being unloaded by sweating bare-backed men or swung into barges with block and tackle. Not even many fishing boats went out in these days. Trade had virtually ceased since Maya had taken the city. The few vessels being loaded bore plunder from the palace and would creep up the coast to her heartland. In a shady office, two clerks played Tobruk, the elaborately decorated board between them, the pieces white, red, green and black, spaced across the battleground with its stylized blue waves. The silence was absolute as the players concentrated on the tactics that would thwart accident, the winds, their opponent, and bring about their strategic aims. A tap at the door, a shadow falling across the Tobruk board, both men looking up, alert, anxious.
"Oh, sorry to interrupt. I'm looking for the shipping clerk."
The players breathed again. Unexpected entrances rarely boded well these days, but this fellow looked friendly enough. A thin man, slightly sallow, his clothes expensive, probably a merchant, and thus as underemployed as the clerks.
"Who are you?"
The elder of the two men stood. He was tall and loomed over the visitor. His companion slipped to the side of the room, where his hand wrapped around the handle of a club leaning against the wall.
"I am Ibn Bai, slave merchant. I have imported many slaves through this port in the old days."
"I am the shipping clerk. What do you want? I doubt you have a cargo due in. I hope for your sake you do not."
Ibn Bai shook his head and grinned. "No cargo? Aren't you expecting me?"
A silence, broken by the creak of the floor, and the man with the club moved closer. Ibn Bai said,
"I am looking for the Iblis."
The tall clerk nodded. His companion stepped back.
"Come with me, merchant."
He vanished through an inner door.
Should he follow the clerk? Ibn Bai wondered. After all, he knew nothing about the fellow. He might be robbed, murdered. On the other hand, he'd paid well for the contact. And was it even possible to turn around and get out past the man with the club?
He shrugged, entered, and sat down on a cushion.
"Who told you about the Iblis?"
"Mitra, the merchant. He's an old friend. He said you'd be expecting me."
"He said too much."
The clerk's face was closed. Ibn Bai was adept at reading expressions, but there was nothing to read. The silence went on, until at last the clerk got abruptly to his feet and went to a cupboard and pulled out a ledger, which he flipped open.
"Party of three?
You are the Iblis, yes?"
"I am the man who can get you out of this city. That's all you need to know. Party of three?" Yes, my daughter, she's expecting a baby. The Iblis waved the words aside as if they didn't matter in the least. Party of three tonight.
That's the thing, Ibn Bai said. That's why I've come. I need to delay our departure. My daughter's husband has gone missing, and she won't leave without him.
Impossible. The Iblis was obviously a man of few words. I've paid the money. Surely another boat will be leaving.
You don't understand. So I will make it clear, my friend. For you, there is one boat. It leaves tonight. Once at sea, you will transfer to an Abraxian trader making for Cyrene. That is what you have paid for. That is what you will get. One chance. The way things are going, there may never be another. Nothing is sure anymore.
There must be... Perhaps the worry. The deep anxiety in Ibn Bai's voice drew forth some speck of kindness from the Iblis. He laid a hand on the merchant's thin shoulder.
Get your daughter out of Tumanbay for her sake and the sake of her child. Our time is short enough on this world, and to have a grandchild to pass on to the future is a precious gift indeed. The husband has probably been rounded up by one of the patrols.
He has a fiery temper,
Ibn Bai admitted.
Then it is unlikely you can help him. If he escapes, he might make his own way across the desert, but a pregnant woman, that is a different matter.
He shook his head and clicked his teeth in sympathy.
It's up to you. This is the last boat.
He named a price a good deal higher than one Mitra had mentioned, but Ibn Bai knew it was a seller's market. He shrugged and pulled out his purse and placed 10 gold coins in the hand of the Iblis, who handed back a scrap of paper with the time and place of embarkation.
You have made a wise decision. There is nothing here now for men like you. Best be gone.
He went to the door and held it open. Ibn Bai passed out of the shop back into the stifling air. He needed mint tea or a coffee. He needed to think, to find some way of persuading his daughter Heaven that they must leave. He knew of a couple of places frequented by the traders who used to work from the docks, and though the first had closed, the second was still open, and he hurried in out of the heat. A few tables were occupied, but Ibn Bai didn't recognize any acquaintances. Before Maya, the Cafe of the Doves had been alive with chatter and laughter. Deals were made from dawn to dusk. The various pricing levels for the city slave markets were unofficially set from here, whilst gallons of strong black coffee were drunk and a mountain of honey cakes, dates, creams and fancies were consumed. It was the first port of call for any newcomer in the trade to visit where, within a few days and with judicious use of his gold, he could get to know 50 men and women of influence in the business. Ibn Bai had deeply enjoyed his days here and, looking around now, felt an equally deep sadness at the shabbiness and emptiness of the old place. A bored waiter set down coffee, water and a cake without being asked. He nodded.
Ibn Bai, we don't see you so much these days.
The market's not what it was, my friend.
This was all too true. The occupiers had taken the strongest and healthiest slaves and sent them to join Maya's conquering armies in the furthest reaches, leaving only the second-rate goods for the city merchants.
Well, maybe I can put something your way, my friend.
The waiter indicated a corner of the cafe where a fat man in a nondescript robe sat, his beady eyes fixed on Ibn Bai.
This fellow came asking for you.
By name?
Yes. Wanted to know if you came in very often. He was here yesterday afternoon. He's from the palace, he says, and frightened half to death if the stink of him is any indication. Just wants to talk.
Offered this.
He slipped a half-gold coin from his sleeve and laid it beside Ibn Bai's cup.
This is not the time to talk to strangers, my friend. You should tell him.
But it was too late. The large man settled at the table, his robe fluttering around him in the breeze of his arrival, and the waiter was quite right, the stink of his fear. He smiled, or at least arranged his features in what might have passed for a smile had there been any goodwill behind it.
I used to love coming here to see all the slaves, big, small, dark, pale. There was so much variety, so much to choose from, but now, he shrugged.
True, Ibn Bai said, and waited.
And so one must turn to other commodities.
Ibn Bai drank his coffee. He considered the cake, but had lost his appetite. Perhaps, he said, and waited.
For instance, books, paintings, artworks.
That would be forbidden.
Again, that smile.
This man was a courtier, of that Ibn Bai was certain now. One of the old regime, not the new.
And thus profitable? I understand you have some experience in these items.
This was dangerous talk. No wonder the man was scared.
Ibn Bai pushed his chair back and stood and spoke loudly so any spy could hear. I am sorry, Effendi. I don't know who you are and I don't know what you are talking about.
He took in the pale, stricken features before him for one moment, then turned and hurried out and practically ran home. Times were hard, but Ibn Bai still employed a gatekeeper who spotted his master as he approached the compound puffing and sweating. The gate swung open to receive him, and without stopping, he careered on into the house where he found Heaven waiting. Big with child, she had come more and more to resemble her mother when she had been pregnant. Ibn Bai couldn't look at her without a sharp pang of loss for Ila, but more urgent was the need to protect his daughter, to get her to safety, whatever the cost. And yet her first words were,
"Did you manage to delay?"
He cut her off.
"The last boat leaves tonight. We must be on it. There won't be another."
"Then you can go alone, father."
Like her mother again, the same tilt of the head, the slightly narrowed eyes, and the tensed jaw, she would not be put aside from her purpose. And yet she must be if they were to survive. A keeper can take care of himself, Heaven. You know that.
She shook her head. Of course she knew it, but she loved this man. She would stand by him until the end. The two had met when Akiba had taken Heaven hostage aboard the slaver that was carrying her and her mother as passengers to Tumanbay. He had escaped with her, and they had undergone many adventures before finally making their way to the city. And on that journey, they had come to respect and then love each other. The marriage that Ibn Bai had arranged for his daughter was set aside, and now she and Akiba were steadfast.
"You have to think about the child." "Shall I call for tea? Something to eat? You should rest, father. You look
frustrated, my dear, dear child."
"I'll go," and she turned to leave the room.
"Please, Heaven, wait. Listen to me. You don't have to answer. Just listen. Will you do that?"
She turned back and stood with one hand on the curve of her belly, the other on her hip, just like her mother. Ibn Bai wondered for a moment if he was like his father in many ways.
"Go on."
"It's been 3 days. He went out, he didn't come back. Either that means he's been rounded up or he's stuck somewhere in a closed part of the city. You know they've been conducting house searches looking for valuables. In either case, you can't help him. I can't help him. My contacts have all gone to ground. Above all, you can't help him by staying here. He would want you to be safe, the baby to be safe. He knows where we'll be. When he gets away, he can cross the desert, get passage to Cyrene. He'll find us. You know he will. The man is unstoppable."
A smile touched her lips.
"He's a survivor, Heaven. You know that. He'll be waiting for his chance. He'll come here, see that we've gone. He'll know what to do, and..."
He fell silent.
"And what?" she asked. "What happened today, father?"
She could read him as easily as her mother had.
"Tell me."
"Someone approached me."
"Someone? Who? What do you mean?"
"From the palace, I think. He wanted to sell me things, forbidden things. Maybe, I don't know, he was testing me. Maybe he was genuine. I don't know, but either way, I think I might be on a list because of my library. I think they might be investigating me."
Chapter 6. Qudali. He was a fool. He should never have given in to the weakness
wandering around the old market, approaching the merchant like that. Who knew what ears might have been listening in that place? God knows he'd made enough enemies in his time, and now he was offering his throat to the blade. He hurried through the lower levels of the palace. No one stopped him. There were no suspicious glances, no commands to halt and offer his wrists for the irons. But he needed to regain his ground. He stopped by a window and looked down at a courtyard where chests were being carried out and piled on wagons for transportation. Yes, that was the answer. Be even more assiduous in his service to Maya and her regent. There were still many secrets in Tumanbay. A whole hoard of them he could offer up one by one as if, yes, as if he were working day and night to search out every last hidden source of wealth for his masters and their terrible mistress. It had been said that Maya had spent time in the city after the conquest, and that her will, her eye, saw all and forgave nothing. Certainly her grip on Tumanbay was as strong as iron, and yet as subtle as a strand of spider silk in the wind. And not simply because of her prelates, or the Black Guard, or even of the Inquisitor himself. They controlled streets and squares and alleys, councils and committees. She had a grip on the very soul of the city. She was everything and nothing. She lived in the dreams and nightmares of the citizens. She was unknowable and terrible. And it was said that one day she would disappear, and that day would be the end of days. Without breaking pace, Kadali went up the winding stairs to his rooms like a man half his age and two-thirds of his weight. He would, of course, need to secure his pictures and the scrolls, but that was no problem. Didn't he know every nook and cranny of the palace, even better than Gregor, that man of secrets? He unlocked his door and hurried into his chambers. The sooner he moved the pictures, separated himself from them, the better. And he would need to do something about Gregor, who knew too much about... What? On the couch. On the floor. On the window ledge. Were pictures. Miniatures from his collection. Surely he hadn't... Of course he hadn't. Bile rose in his throat as the Inquisitor appeared in the bedroom door. In his hand, an album from across the Middle Sea. Engravings from the antique world. Has it been a stressful day? He handed the book to Kadali, who let it fall from lifeless fingers. I've been looking for you. Oh, yes. A mouse might have made more noise. I went to the Hall of Mirrors, but I couldn't find you there. I thought, well, perhaps he's in the gold room, taking care of the latest dispatch, recording every last item. What a diligent fellow. But you weren't there either. He picked up a miniature from the sill and regarded it. These are fine works, so lifelike. How do these artists capture such likeness? I think they have lenses to... Could he really be having this conversation? This was madness. How had Barakat entered and relocked the door? Did he have keys to every room in the palace? Lenses? To focus the image, reduce it, and... Of course he did. Like the plague, the Inquisitor could go where he wished. What a fool he'd been, Kadali thought, to believe that anyone could be safe in this hell. Now, Kadali... The question that goes through my mind is, why aren't these items entered into the registry of treasures from the palace? Were they perhaps stolen? Not by me, Holiness, never, never would I even think of, never. He managed to shut himself up, take a deep breath and start again like an innocent man. I have been meticulous in cataloguing everything of value in the palace. These were... He was walking towards the edge of a cliff. Barakat said, yours? He picked the album up from the carpet and laid it on the couch, flipping the pages to show softly swelling curves, mighty muscles, heroes and heroines of past times immortalized first in marble
and now engraved here, in his book, on his couch, in his room, in his possession. If he had indeed been standing at the edge of a cliff, he might have stepped off. As it was, he mumbled, "They were in my care." Barakat closed the book. It shut like a coffin lid on Kadali's future.
"I am asking myself, why would a devout man keep such items? Why would such a man who believes in Maya and her mission hide such things away?
Is it his purpose to pervert the thoughts of others, to mock the truth, to save the idolatrous, to comfort the unbelievers?" Each question was another nail in that coffin lid. Or is he simply weak? A glimmer of light.
Think carefully before you answer, my friend. Weakness, greed, I understand. But blasphemy?
It was greed, Holiness. Frailty. I intended to sell them. I asked Gregor for advice. He told me to go to the market. I am weak, so weak. Help me be strong, Holiness.
He fell to his knees and grasped handfuls of the Inquisitor's robe.
I understand. Everyone makes mistakes. Thank you. Thank you.
Barakat pulled his tear-wet robe from Kadali's grasp and squatted so they were eye to eye.
I can help you. If you commit to me, Kadali, you will be saved. I do not lie. I never lie. Do you truly and with your whole soul so commit?
I do, Kadali sobbed. I will be your man, Holiness.
Then we can help each other. Would you like that?
Kadali nodded. It was as if a great burden had been lifted from his shoulders. Barakat stood and raised the crumpled, damp ex-vizier to his feet.
Good. Now, who did you see at the market? What name did Gregor give you?
Chapter 7. Gregor. If Tumanbay had become a fallen city, if Tumanbay had found itself under the rule of an iron-hard code of behaviour and belief, it hadn't yet managed to achieve the odour of sanctity which, the ancient texts tell us, partakes of saffron and vanilla, rose water and sweet oranges, acacia leaves and honey. At least, not in the cells beneath the palace. And in all his time as commander of the palace guard, Gregor had never known the stink and the number of prisoners so high. As he descended through the levels by the ancient spiral staircase with its flaming sconces, passing guards every few steps, many of them once under his command, he could not recall a time, even when Sultan al-Ghuri had been at his most suspicious, when there had been so many poor wretches detained here, and this was only for the so-called important prisoners. The ordinary folk were housed in the city prisons, filled to bursting, or kept behind wooden stockades which had been built in the old army district. Confinement had become an industry in this new world. Gregor noticed the guards down here wore their black headbands over their faces. His eyes stung from streams of urine which ran from under the door of packed cells and pooled on the stairs. A constant background of wails and cries and screams and the bellows of the mad or desperate sounded around him. Even the flames were almost guttering in the unbreathable air and cast a ghastly gloom that might have lit the infernal regions themselves. And here, at the lowest point, the far north of the human soul, he reached his destination. A guard by the cell door came to attention. Gregor peered through the murk. He recognized the man. He had served under Gregor, but there was no recognition or friendship in his eyes now.
"You wish to see the prisoner?"
"I do."
He unlocked the door and handed Gregor a flaming torch. Qulan looked up. his eyes squinting against the unfamiliar light. He was thinner, his face haggard and lined, but no less determined. He was sitting on a stone shelf, which served as bed and table. A stone jar stood on it, a crust of bread beside it.
"You must lower the torch, whoever you are. We're not used to the light down here. You will find a sconce on the wall. You may lodge it there."
The voice still held vestiges of command. Gregor did as he was directed and stood in the centre of the cell.
"Oh, it's you," Qulan said. "You finally managed to find the time to come and see me. Or was it the courage?"
"How are you, brother?" Gregor replied.
"Never better. And you? Are your new masters taking good care of you? You're looking well fed."
"You could be eating as well yourself, brother. It is your choice."
Qulan snorted with derision.
"And why have they sent you down here?"
"Maya is victorious. She rules the city," Gregor said loud and clear. "Her regent, Effendi Red, has no animosity towards you. He respects your abilities. He wishes you to serve, not to rot down here. Can't you see, brother? Maya's truth."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.